This is the iPhone 12, and I've had it for a bit over 3 months now, and I think it's about time I do a long-term review of this device. Is it a good phone to get now in 2021? And do its features match up with all of the other devices out there today? Hey guys, my name's Imtihan. I like to talk about tech. If you want to join the conversation, make sure to subscribe to the channel, and if you like this type of content, drop a like on the video. It helps us reach more people and grows our audience. The iPhone 12 was released in October 2020, and it replaces the outgoing iPhone 11 series. There are a couple of significant changes with the iPhone 12 compared to the iPhone 11. Gone are the curved edges. They were replaced with a much more squared off design that harkens back to the iPhone 5S series of phones. It's a blast from the past with some modern touches that make this phone feel extremely premium. Also, the sizes are also changing. Whereas with the iPhone 11 and 10 series, you had a 5.8 inch phone and a 6.7 inch larger device, with the iPhone 12, there's now three sizes to choose from. You have the 5.4 inch iPhone 12 mini, the standard iPhone 12, which is 6.1 inch, the iPhone 12 Pro, which is also at 6.1 inch, and the iPhone 12 Pro Max, which you can get at a whopping 6.8 inch size. That's getting really close to the iPad mini in terms of actual screen area. So I actually got the iPhone 12. The reason I went for the iPhone 12 and not the Pro version or the mini is because the iPhone 12 was actually a good balance for price to features when it comes to iPhones. iPhones are not the cheapest phones out there, but there are actually now options at almost every price point. If you want to go more budget, you can go for some of the SE models, some of the older iPhones. Because I upgrade every 3 or 4 years, I wanted a phone that would last me well into the future without really dropping in terms of performance or ease of use. So the iPhone 12 standard edition is what I got. I didn't need the extra camera of the iPhone 12 Pro, and the stainless steel construction isn't something that appeals to me, mainly because I put a case on my phone. This is a basic cheap Amazon case that I got for 13 bucks. I'll have it linked in the description below if you want to check it out, and it works perfectly fine. The design of the phone is stellar. It's very sturdily built. You're not going to get any bend gate issues on the iPhone 11, even though it's aluminum and not actually stainless steel. This is a very solid device, and considering it's a couple of $100 cheaper than the iPhone 12 Pro models, while not really missing out on that many features, all it's missing is a third camera, the LiDAR sensor, and the ability to shoot Apple ProRes RAW, I don't really think it's that much of a sacrifice going for the iPhone 12 model compared to the 12 Plus. Especially when you consider that the iPhone 12 model is also equipped with the same OLED display as the iPhone 12 Pro variants. In previous generation, the iPhone XS and the 11, the Pro variants were the only ones that actually got the OLED display, but Apple's decided to put those in the iPhone 12 variants this year, which makes this a great option if you really care about display. You don't really have to pay the premium to get the Pro versions anymore. So let's talk a little bit about the display. This is a 6.1 inch display, and it's slightly above 1080p in terms of resolution, especially because of the taller than normal aspect ratio. This is not 16:9. And it's also a Retina display, which means it has relatively high PPI, so there's a lot of pixels crammed into a small space. That means you're gonna get a lot of resolution in a small display. Text looks clean and crisp. If you're scrolling through social media or reading an article on Wikipedia, you'll be comfortably able to read it on this device without many issues or significant eye strain. The display on this phone is also HDR capable, so if you have HDR content that you can play it using HDR on this device. The display also gets really bright, so if you're out into the sun, you're not really going to have issues looking at things on the screen, even if it's really bright out. The display quality is pretty much identical to the display quality of the iPhone 12 Pro, Pro Max, and the iPhone 12 mini. The only thing that changes is the resolution based on the size of the screen. So on this one, it's slightly above 1080p in terms of display. The 6.8 inch screen is going to be slightly higher resolution, but it has that slight difference in pixels per inch. But none of these things are really noticeable. The displays are great for everyday use, and unless you're really pixel peeping or looking at things really close, you're not going to notice a difference between the three displays. I think 6.1 inch is a very comfortable size for me. I'm coming from the iPhone 7 Plus, so this is a big upgrade in screen size, but the whole overall body actually feels very similar in the hand as the 7 Plus did with a case on. Now that we've talked a little bit about the display, let's talk about what's powering this display. The A14 chip out of Apple. This is a very interesting chip. It's the first 5-nanometer fabricated mobile chip that came out in the market. Since then, Snapdragon's actually come out with the Snapdragon 888, and you were slowly starting to see that pop up on Android phones. But Apple was first to the game, and Apple has an amazing reputation for putting the best silicon they can on these phones. Even last year's iPhone 11 and 11 Pros actually beat out almost every single Android phone out there in terms of benchmarks and raw performance output, while also maintaining great efficiency and standby times. So going with a smaller processor this year gives us significantly better efficiency gains, but also it gives Apple more room to put more silicon in and to accelerate tasks that they otherwise would have a much more difficult time doing. So the new Apple A14 chip actually has 40% more transistors in it. This means you're getting a lot more silicon. It can do a lot more things at once. And that just means you're going to get an overall better experience out of this phone compared to some of the older devices. Now, the difference is significant between the previous generation iPhone and this one, but you're not really going to notice the difference right away, especially because the iPhone 11 chip was actually already overpowered for what iOS 13 and iOS 14 can do today. The actual power of this chip is going to become much more relevant in 2-3 years. When you continue to use this phone, it continues to get updates and new features start to pop up that take advantage of the extra power. But for today, this chip is plenty powerful. Switching between different apps is a breeze. It's very fast, it's very quick. It can even game at pretty good settings for most applications. But even with the power on this chip, if you're running high graphical fidelity games on this chip, you'll still have to play around with the settings to get something that's optimal and works for you. I tested the phone out on Genshin Impact, running it at the highest settings on 30 FPS, and at certain points during gameplay, it did stutter slightly. And I also noticed that if you ran it on high settings and tried to push for 60 FPS, it ran, but it overheated the phone fairly quickly and it started to lag really quickly. The phone felt very uncomfortable in my hand if I tried running Genshin Impact on high settings at 60 FPS. But as soon as it dropped down to 30 FPS, the heat output was much less, the phone felt comfortable in my hand, and gameplay was smooth. So if you're playing high fidelity games on this phone, make sure to tune the settings correctly so that you can play for long times without really having that many issues. Okay, so let's move on to the next feature. And this is a feature that Apple really pushes on their iPhones. And that's actually the camera quality. The iPhone 12 actually comes with a wide angle lens camera and a normal 1x zoom camera. One thing you may not know is that the cameras in each of these lenses are not the same. Standard lens camera is actually significantly better in terms of quality than the wide angle lens camera, and you'll actually see that in some of the tests I'm about to show you guys. In the iPhone 12, the standard camera can actually collect a lot more light than the wide angle camera. This means you're going to get much better low light performance, but I also noticed that the colors out of the standard camera is actually more vibrant than the wide angle camera. The wide angle camera produces more muted colors and is also more grainy even with good lighting in the room. I tested these two features out side by side with pictures and video, and I'll have them on the display right now so you can take a look at the exact differences. The next feature I want to test out is the low light performance of these cameras. This is something that Apple heavily advertised, and it's important to see if it works well. So in this room, I have actually two lights that I can change the intensity on. So the test I did is actually I took a picture of the Rubik's Cube with these lights on full brightness, and then I took them at half brightness. And then for the third test, I actually turned off one and turned the second one on to the lowest light output it could get. I was really impressed. Here are the three pictures. So you guys tell me if you can see a difference between the three images. Tell me which one you think is the image that was taken with the lights on full brightness, medium brightness, and low brightness. Personally, I can tell what the lowest brightness image was, but from the middle and high brightness image, it's kind of hard to tell. It's a similar story for video. If you're going out at night and you want to record some stuff, video quality is actually still great for the most part. If you have some street lights coming in and out, if you have some store signages, then this camera actually captures all of those details relatively easily. One thing to note, however, is that if you have a light source in front of the camera, sometimes there's small lens flares that happen, and it's much more noticeable at night when you have a single or two light sources in or around you, and the light produces a lens flare or a reflection on the lens, and it creates spots on other parts of the image that you won't typically see in normal DSLR cameras or digital cameras. This is a known issue that existed in the iPhone 11 too, and it's sad to see that Apple hasn't been able to fix that on this device. If you're upgrading to the iPhone 12 for the camera and you have something 2 or 3 years old, you're going to notice a massive difference in the quality of the pictures and videos that come out of this device. Apple did a great job with their computational photography and video, and it's amazing to see what they've been able to achieve running hardware that's really small. Kudos to Apple for that. Although I would like to see that lens flare issue be solved in future iterations. So what are some of the other features of this phone that you might want to take a look at? Well, there's MagSafe. So Apple's put a magnetic ring around this device here so you can attach accessories to this. I haven't bought any of these accessories, and the main reason for that is right now I think they're fairly overpriced. The case I got for this phone was 13 bucks on Amazon. It came with a screen protector. The Anker wireless charger that I have was under $20, and it charges relatively fast and works perfectly fine for me. if you are interested in using MagSafe accessories, remember that those accessories do cost a bit more than your typical accessories that don't have MagSafe. So it's something that you want to keep in mind when you're budgeting out for an iPhone 12. The final thing I wanted to bring up is what comes in the box of the iPhone 12. So you get the phone, you get the charging cable, but you don't actually get a wall plug with it. That's typically a problem for a lot of people if they don't have a USB wall plug lying around from a previous phone. So this would have been nice to see be included in this device, especially considering that the cable you get in this phone is actually a USB Type-C to Lightning cable. There's not a lot of phones that have USB Type-C wall plugs. You're probably going to have to buy a new wall plug to use this phone. Fortunately, the USB-C wall plug that Apple sells is not that expensive. It's actually only $25 in Canada, just under 20 bucks if you're in the US. There's also many third-party alternatives that are high quality and actually I think sometimes better than the Apple accessories that you can get from Amazon for fairly cheap. I'll have some of those linked below. So that's my long-term review of the iPhone 12 in 2021. I'm someone that upgrades phones every 4 to 5 years. I upgraded to the iPhone 12 from the iPhone 7 Plus, which I got 4 years ago. I'm happy with this upgrade. There's a significant performance bump from the phone that I had to this phone. The difference in screen quality was great. Battery life was about the same. It lasts a full day perfectly fine for me. The speakers are actually much better in this one. And overall, I think this is a pretty solid design choice that Apple made. One thing I would like to have seen is the notch get a little bit smaller, and maybe if they had a variable refresh rate display that went up to 90 hertz, because that can make the phone feel that much better and faster. But those are nitpicky features. If you want a solid phone that's reliable, that'll work in almost any condition, that'll do most things you want to do well without too much hassle, then the iPhone 12 is for you. It's not a cheap phone, and it's also not the most expensive phone. It's a good balance of the highest end features you can expect to have in a premium phone without going so over the top that the cost becomes unreasonable for most of us. So what do you guys think of the iPhone 12? Drop your thoughts on the comments down below. And while you're down there, make sure to drop a like on this video. It helps us reach more people and grows our community. That's everything from me today. Thanks for watching, and remember to always keep learning. Bye-bye.